Let us stand while we ask Sister Joan to read the Bible.
Good morning, everyone. We're going to start by reading from John chapter 1, and we're reading from verse 1 to 17 from the King James Version. Reading. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them he gave power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bare witness of him and cried, saying, This was he of whom I speak. He that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his fullness have all we received, and grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Here ends the reading for this morning.
Praise the Lord. We'll ask Sister Elaine, we have to bless the morning service.
Good morning. Good morning to the church and those who are viewing online with us. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come before you right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we just want to thank you for this beautiful day that we could come into your presence this morning to worship you in spirit and in truth. We just want to thank you, Lord, for even keeping us during the night, Lord, watching over us. And this morning, this new day, we come into your presence, dear Heavenly Father, because we know you are worthy of our praises this morning. Father, we bring this service before you right now. Lord, we ask that you will remember the worship team right now. Father, we ask your blessings upon them. We pray you'll touch them. We pray you'll anoint them, Lord. And as we sing the songs of the sanctuary, our souls will be blessed and encouraged. Remember the musicians also, the technical team. Father, we pray that you will run everything to the honor and glory of your name. We even bring your word before you right now, the one that has to bring it forth. We ask your blessings upon that person. We pray you'll touch them, dear Heavenly Father. And as we sit, Lord, to listen to your word, because we come to receive from you today, dear Heavenly Father, we pray, God, that as the word goes forth, Lord, it will touch someone in the name of Jesus. Even remember our pastor this morning. Thank you for her. Continue to stand by her and her and the assistant pastor right now, Lord. And the congregation here, dear Heavenly Father, we just want to worship you. We just want to thank you, Lord. We just want to give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise. And at the end, Lord, we can say it was good that we were in the house of the Lord. Bless us another time in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hallelujah. The scripture reading, read that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And today, we are celebrating the Word that came down from heaven as a little babe, and he has died. And now he's seated at the right hand of God. So this morning, we're going to sing, How Great is Our God. We keep on seeing how great our God is. He is bigger than all the mountains. He is bigger than all our problems. So let's keep singing that God is great. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Worthy is the Lamb. Hallelujah. Thank you.
redemption. We join them now as we lift our voice, we cry, worthy, worthy is the Lamb. The angels bow down in adoration. We join them now as we lift our voice, we cry, worthy, worthy is the Lamb.
And let us just rejoice in the name of the Lord. So our next song will be Rejoice. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Hallelujah.
We'll sing this last song. And if you haven't put the offering, you please do so while we sing this one. And then Sister Farley will come.
Thank you.
Now we can be seated while Sister Mary came and come and gave the announcement. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Oh, first we bless the offering. Sorry.
Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for another opportunity, Lord, to come into your sanctuary, Lord, and to give you praise and to give you worship, Lord. Father, truly your presence is here, Lord. And we ask, Lord, that you will magnify this place in the name of Jesus. Father, let everything that is said and done today be said and done to your honor and your glory. Father, we bring this offering before you. We ask you, Lord, to bless the hands that gave, Lord. We ask you, Lord, to provide for those who didn't have to give, Lord, so that they can too sow into your kingdom for your honor and your glory, Lord. We give you thanks, Lord. We ask you to bless the hands, Lord, that will spend it for your honor and your glory. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will continue to rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Aren't you glad this morning that you are in the presence of the Lord? Amen. Let's begin with our Christian Mission Headquarters announcements for week commencing Sunday, December the 12th, 2021. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. Our General Superintendent, the Board of Management, ministers and pastors and assistant pastors extend season's greetings to all members and their family. Remember, Jesus is the reason for the season. Today's worship experience will be live streamed on Facebook and YouTube from our Stroude Christian Mission Church at 11 a.m. Join them on our Southern Circuit Facebook page. Our prayer warriors of intercessors thank all who participated in the prayer and fasting from December the 6th to the 8th and encourage everyone to continue fervent in prayer against the prevailing COVID-19 pandemic. Our Panama Christian Mission expresses sincere thanks for all the support given to them for their 99th anniversary celebrations. Please be extremely vigilant in your observation of the government's COVID-19 protocols. The funeral service for Sister Millicent Welch will take place on Tuesday, the 14th of December at 10 a.m. at St. Matthew's Anglican Church. Viewing of the body will take place today, December the 12th, at the Jackson Christian Mission from 3 to 5 p.m. Continue to keep the Welch family in our prayers. The first part of the pastor's Christmas offering was collected today, December the 12th. Continue fervent in prayer and fasting for the conclusion of the Hillaby Christian Missions building project. The various ministries of the Church International, the sick and shut-ins, and families of our dearly departed, Reverend Joel D. Hope, General Superintendent. Praise the Lord. And now to our local announcements. This morning we extend a very special welcome to everyone who is worshiping with us in the sanctuary and those of you who are viewing us online. Thanks to the ladies' ministry for conducting the early morning prayer session yesterday. Sister Natalie Pierce was the facilitator, and she did a wonderful job. The exhortation reminded us of the numerous promises of God. It was refreshing and encouraging. The prayers were divinely anointed. To God be the glory and praise. Amen. We also thank the youth ministry for facilitating the final Zoom session on Wednesday night. Sister Joanne engaged us in a very interesting discussion. Thanks to the participants. May God continue to bless their ministry. On behalf of the church, we convey condolences to Sister Waif and Joanne on the passing of Sister Waif's sister-in-law in London, and Sister Natalie on the passing of her husband, Mark's sister-in-law. May God comfort and strengthen them in their period of bereavement. Please remember them in your prayers. Our annual church meeting will take place here on Tuesday night, the 14th of December at 7 p.m. Please try to be present. Continue to pray for our Sunday school students, the youth, ladies' ministry, sign language, mentorship, and dance ministries, the senior members, and those who are ill. Praise the Lord. And this morning, on this, the second Sunday in the lovely month of December, we're sending out birthday greetings to Pastor Conliffe and our worship leader, Sister Karen Edwards. They will celebrate their birthdays on the 15th and 17th of December. We wish them both a happy birthday and God's continual blessings. And Sister Joanne will lead us in the happy birthday song for Sister Karen and Pastor Conliffe. Thank you.
Happy birthday to you.
Maria, and I pray that God will use her this morning, and as she sent out, oh, Pastor Forrest, come, yes. Then Sister Maria.
Praise the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. I am so happy this morning, the second Sunday in the month of December, to extend a very warm welcome to everyone fellowshipping with us today. And we are extremely glad to see some of our families that we haven't seen for a little while as a result of reduction in numbers. And we are glad to have the Simpson family with us today. And today we are blessed to have a full complement of musicians. Amen. Amen. A full complement. All the works we have are, as usual, our faithful, devoted, dedicated Brother Archer on the guitar. And this morning, we have on the drums our Brother Andrew, and accompanying him is his dad, our Brother Cameron, who is responsible for our music ministry and the Christian mission, and our dear beloved Brother Justin Bridgman from the Darius Hill Christian Mission. A full compliment today. And we are also blessed to have our Brother Christian Wiggins with us back from overseas, joining the technical team, along with our Brother Deshaun, our Sister Moesha, and Sister Alicia, all operating video cameras and all the works of it. So God is a good God this morning, and it would be remiss of me not to extend a very warm thank you to our security personnel none other than a reliable, dependable Brother Larry Brathwaite. So let's put our hands together for him and our ushers this morning, beautifully attired in their white and black and black and white. Our sister Elisa multitasking and our sister Heather Jackman Hunt. So we give God thanks for everybody present in his sanctuary. And we are divinely anointed and divinely blessed this morning as a result of the worship. So Yvonne has a relative that will be journeying tomorrow. We wish her a safe journey and mercies. And we have already prayed that God would take her and her family in peace and in safety. And we are always happy and blessed to have those of you online worshiping with us. And we had seen a little dip in our views, but thank God they are returning to a bit more normality. So we are thankful and we pray that as we come down to the conclusion of the year, that you will not lose your interest or your focus, but that you will continue to fellowship with us because our God has been good to us. So at this time, it gives me great joy to hand back over to our sister Kieran, who will continue in leading worship. God bless you, Sister Kieran and Joanne. Praise the Lord.
Thank you. We were singing this song before our speaker come, which is Sister Maria. Still.
I
Good morning. Good morning to the church, and good morning to those of you watching online. It's indeed a wonderful privilege to be in the house of the Lord this morning, and I want to thank the worship team for leading us in such a wonderful session of worship. Indeed, our God is worthy. Amen. Amen. So let us say a short prayer. Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for this opportunity, Lord God. I just want to thank you for your goodness, Lord God, and for your mercy. I want to thank you, Lord God, because you are worthy, Lord God, and you have promised, Lord God, and you are faithful in keeping your promises, Lord. So even now as I bring this short word before your people, Lord, I pray that someone will be blessed and encouraged to continue every step of the way, and we just give you all the honor, glory, and the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to be reading this morning from Luke chapter 1, and we're going to read from verse 5 to 20. In the King James Version, Luke 1, 5 to 20. And it reads, "There was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest named Zacharias, of the course of Abia, and his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elisabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord blameless. And they had no child, because that Elisabeth was barren. And they were both well now, they were both well stricken in years. And it came to pass that while he executed the priest's office before God in the order of his course, according to the custom of the priest's office, his lot was to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. And the whole multitude of the people were praying without at the time of incense. And there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord, standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zacharias saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said unto him, Fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard. And thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. And thou shalt have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth. For he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. And he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost, even from his mother's womb. And many of the children of Israel shall he turn to the Lord their God. And he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elias to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the justice, to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. And Zacharias said unto the angel, Whereby shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife well stricken in years. And the angel answering said unto him, I am Gabriel, that stand in the presence of God, and am sent to speak unto thee, and to show thee these glad tidings. And behold, thou shalt be dumb, and not able to speak, until the day that these things shall be performed, because thou believest not my words, which shall be fulfilled in their season. Amen. You may take your seats. So just a little background. When I first was given the assignment to speak this morning, I had a totally different topic in mind. I had even started gathering ideas and drafting notes on that topic. But then on Thursday, I got some disappointing news. And that night, as I was reading a devotional on the Bible app, the author posed a question, which made me rethink my topic for this morning. The question was, what happens in your heart when God doesn't give you what you want? It was divinely orchestrated that I read that devotional on Thursday night, given the news I had received that day. And as I meditated on it during the night, I felt led to change my topic to don't lose hope. I believe this topic is appropriate given the pastor's encouragement last week to wait on the Lord, as well as Sister Joan on Wednesday night who would have gone through worth the wait. And even yesterday morning at our early morning prayer service, there were many references to waiting on God patiently as Sister Natalie went through the promises of God. So this morning, don't lose hope. Now, our passage is a part of the Christian story that we tend to gloss over. We don't really think about Zacharias and Elizabeth much. They're just the parents of John the Baptist, and they kind of play supporting roles to the main characters in the Christmas story. But this morning, we will focus a little on their story. So now verses 6 and 7 tell us three key details about this couple. Firstly, they were righteous in God's eyes, careful to obey all the Lord's commandments and regulations. Secondly, they were childless because Elisabeth was unable to conceive. And finally, they were both now very old. It's not clear exactly how old they were, but definitely Elisabeth was way past childbearing age. Now if we think and we read our Bibles, we go to Psalm 84:11, which tells us, "For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory, and no good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly." So the psalmist is declaring that God will not withhold any good thing from us once we're walking uprightly. But when we go back to Zacharias and Elisabeth, clearly they were walking uprightly because that's what verse 6 tells us. So that could not be the issue. And then Psalm 127:3 tells us that children are a heritage of the Lord and the fruit of the womb is his reward. So we know children are a good thing. So clearly this couple met the criteria of Psalm 84:11. So then why was God withholding children from them? Now, I believe when Zacharias and Elisabeth were first married, there was that expectation that they will be fruitful and multiply. It is likely, especially if their culture is similar to other countries, where it's expected the wife will be pregnant within a year. By the first wedding anniversary, there will be a child. But for Zacharias and Elisabeth, first anniversary came and went with no baby. Then the second, and then the third, and then many, many, many more anniversaries, and still no baby. They were living right. They were praying, and yet no baby, until they gave up hope. And that's understandable. So many years of your prayer going unanswered, and that tends to happen. And in some cases, we don't even go years. If what we ask for doesn't happen next week, or, you know, a few months, we're done. We don't want it anymore. We've given up hope. It's not going to happen. But Romans 8:24-25 tells us a very simple and very obvious truth about hope. For we are saved by hope. But hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. Now, the New Living Translation puts it a much easier and more understandable way. If we already have something, we do not need to hope for it. But if we look forward to something that we don't yet have, we must wait patiently and confidently. So for us as Christians, hope is much more than wishful thinking. In the Bible, hope is the confident expectation of what God has promised. And when we are confident in our beliefs, we are not easily swayed. Now, going back to Zacharias, as righteous and devout as he was, over the years, he lost hope that he would father a child. So when the angel Gabriel appeared to him and said that God had heard his prayers and that Elizabeth would bear him a son, he just could not believe it. And we really cannot blame him for being skeptical, because not only was Elizabeth unable to conceive, but she was also long past childbearing age. And according to the rules of human biology, there was no way that she should be able to get pregnant now. And this is what happens when we lose hope. We begin to doubt God's ability, and we limit him to our human ability. Also, as Christians, we have the Bible to refer to as our guide and source of encouragement as we navigate this life. As regular Bible readers, we have encountered many stories of women who were barren, and by God's grace, they were able to conceive. One example that readily comes to mind is that of Abraham and Sarah. And their story, if you think about it, is very similar to Zacharias and Elizabeth, because they were also very old when Isaac was conceived. And we know that since Elizabeth cannot change, what he did for Abraham and Sarah, he could do for Zacharias and Elisabeth. So we know that given the knowledge that we have. But when we think about it, Zacharias was a priest in the New Testament. So he also had this knowledge. He also would have heard of Abraham and Sarah and all the other women in the Old Testament who got pregnant after being barren. So he knew this. But yet, despite this knowledge, Zacharias still lost hope and doubted that God could do the same for him and Elizabeth. And this is what happens when we lose hope. We forget that what God has done in the past, he can most certainly do again. So what happens in our hearts when God does not give us what we want when we want it? Many times we get discouraged, frustrated. We stop praying about it. We stop asking others to pray about it. We start telling other persons what we want. And we begin to doubt God's faithfulness. And eventually we lose hope and just decide it's not going to happen. Or that we just don't want it anymore. But as we discussed on Wednesday night, there are many reasons why God does not give us what we want when we want it. It could be because we're not quite ready for what we want and he's preparing us for it. Or it could be he's protecting us from someone or something as the loving father he is. But the main reason, as our brother Roger reminded us, is that God's ways are not our ways and his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. We have to trust God because he is faithful and he will do what he has promised. In Zacharias and Elizabeth's case, God had a special plan for their child. This child was to be the forerunner of the Christ child. The angel Gabriel listed his characteristics in verses 15 to 17, namely, for he will be great in the eyes of the Lord. He must never touch wine or other alcoholic drinks. He'll be filled with the Holy Spirit even before his birth. And he will turn many Israelites to the Lord their God. He will be a man with the spirit and power of Elijah. He will prepare the people for the coming of the Lord. He will turn the heads of the fathers to their children. And he will cause those who are rebellious to accept the wisdom of the godly. So now we understand the reason for the extremely long delay in answering this couple's prayer for a child. God heard their prayer. And his answer was not to give them any ordinary child. No, this child had a divine purpose of preparing the people for the coming of the Lord. Remember, our God is a God of order. He had an ordained time when Jesus would come to earth in human form. And he had chosen Elizabeth to bear John the Baptist. Therefore, he could not give them a child before the appointed time. Our God sees the bigger picture. Often, when we pray and put our needs before God, we are just thinking about how our request is going to benefit us. I'm sure that Elizabeth would have preferred to have a child in her more youthful and energetic years. But God, seeing the bigger picture and knowing the purpose of this child, had to delay answering her prayer. God's delay in granting our requests is usually for the benefit of others. Yes, God will not withhold any good thing from those who walk uprightly, but he will provide it in his timing, not ours. So today, you may be waiting for a job. You may be waiting for a relationship or for a change in your finances. Or you may be like Elizabeth and trying to conceive. Or you may be praying for healing. Whatever you may be waiting for today, or probably like most of us, we're waiting for the end of the pandemic, but we're waiting for something. I'm going to encourage you not to lose hope. Continue to wait patiently and confidently. And I'll leave you with the words of Hebrews 10:23 from the NIV. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Amen. And now I'll hand over to our sister Farley.
Praise the Lord. Sorry about that little wait, but we are told that we have to wait patiently. We thank Sister Maria for reminding us today of what we are supposed to do. Very often, we say we are waiting, but how are we waiting? Are we really waiting patiently? Or are we complaining every step of the way? Are we saying, yes, I am waiting on the Lord, but in truth and in fact, we are hoping that something else will work out very quickly because we cannot see the end in sight. We do not know what God has promised, but only God alone knows. At this time, we are going to go into our communion service, and we are going to ask you to turn with us to St. Matthew chapter 26, and we are going to read from verses 26 to 30. Amen. And it reads, and as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them saying, drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. And when they had sung with him, they went out into the Mount of Olives. Praise the Lord. We remember today what Jesus did when he had his disciples together and they were expected to participate in the communion service where we are going to take part in the body and blood of Christ. And we are going to have our first hymn at this time, hymn 260, Break Thou the Bread of Life. Our sister Yvonne to play for the ambulance.
Praise the Lord for Jesus. Thank God for dying for us. That is why we have these emblems. I give God praise and thanks. Thank you, Jesus, for your blood, Lord. Thank you for your spirit. Father, we give you thanks, Lord. I don't for God that sent his son to die for us. We don't know what we would be, Lord, or where we would be. But we thank you, dear God. Bless this emblem, Lord. Bless it to our bodies. Lord, as we prepare our hearts, Lord, Lord, to hear from you, to, Lord, to enjoy you, Lord, we give you all the thanks, Lord, for these Christ, break thou the bread of life, dear Lord, to me, as thou did break the loaves beside the sea. Hallelujah, Lord. We give you thanks. Bless it, and as we partake, Lord, we always remember what you have done for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise the Lord. Let us make sure that we all have our emblems together now. And we are going to start with breaking the bread. Let us partake. Praise the Lord. And then we are going to sing the first two verses of the next song while we partake, before we partake of the wine. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Let us partake now of the wine. Praise the Lord. And at this time, we are going to invite our sister Ordine to come and give us the closing prayer. As she comes, we are going to continue singing the other verses to What Can Wash Away My Sins.
Love.
Let us stand. Let us bow our heads. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Heavenly Father, we give you praise and we give you thanks. We thank you, Lord, for allowing us to come into your house to praise and glorify your wonderful name, Lord. Lord, we thank you for everything that has been said and done. We thank you, Lord, for being in our presence. Lord, you said we are twos and threes are gathered together in your name that you are in the midst. So, Lord, we give you thanks this morning. We are thankful to our Sister Maria for reminding us that we shouldn't lose hope. And when we think of whom we are waiting on, then we should continue. And we shouldn't mumble, but we wait patiently because his promises are true. His ways are not our ways, and his thoughts are not our thoughts. So sometimes we lose hope, especially when we are going through tough time. But we know that so long as we keep on trusting God, that he will bring us through. So we ask that the Lord will continue to bless our sister with good measure, pressed down, shaking together, and running over. We are also thankful for our communion service this morning. We remembered that God died on the cross for our sins. And we sincerely hope that we will show our appreciation by being worthy of doing so. So, Lord, we give you thanks and remember this time when people will all be merry. But as we go through this season, we should never forget the reason for the season. So, Lord, we give you thanks for everything. And now that we are about to go to our homes, we ask that you will take us in peace and in safety. These things we ask in your name. For Christ's sake, amen. And let us say it together, may the grace of the Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest now and forever. Amen.